What you are looking at right now is the backend of a real hacking operation. To be more specific, a Steam account hacking operation. And I wanted to talk about this topic for a long time because, first of all, knowing about this will help you to not get hacked. And second, you will see why this has nothing to do with real hacking. Actually, to me, this does not even deserve to be called hacking because this is just cybercrime. Have a look at this site. This looks like a normal modern website, right? It's actually pretty easy to use. Let me walk you through some of the main functionality. In the menu links, you can actually add a new link. You need to register a domain and then add it here. And next, select the website template that looks good to you. So far, this kind of looks like a website builder, like Wix or Squarespace, right? But this is a lot more nefarious. If you look closely, you can see something fishy going on. Well, after you select the template and entered a few other configuration settings, you can finish it up. And there is your finished website, the biggest CSGO skins giveaway 2022. We built a complete website in seconds, and we can even open up a case to get a free skin. Alright, to get it now, we need to log into Steam. Halt, stop, I don't want to be robbed. This, of course, is a Steam phishing page. Log into Steam now, and your account is gone. As far as I understand, they use the credentials to quickly generate a web API key and then use that one to steal your stuff. By the way, I have a video about how to protect yourself from phishing. If you haven't seen it, you should, because in the video I showcase a really well done Steam phishing page. And this begs the question, is this the backend operation of that Steam phishing page? Actually no, these are competitors. These are different cybercrime organizations. But they basically work the same way. So let's dive into how cybercrime actually works in this case, and you will see that it has nothing to do with hacking. So let's start building this cybercrime organizational chart. Here we have the website building tool that we just saw. This tool can be used to create Steam phishing sites. So what's up with this tool? As you can see, this dashboard is actually empty. Zero logs of all time, zero clicks for today, no stolen accounts listed here, empty account. This is because this is an account made by somebody going by the name Cyber who is hunting and taking down these kind of services. And they are obviously not participating in this crime. They just want to get insight into the operation to then figure out a good way to disrupt it. So I guess to understand how this all works, let me tell you how Cyber got this account in the first place. It actually all starts in a hacking or underground forum where the service is advertised. I use hacking in quotation marks because I feel bad to call this hacking. In reality, this is just a crime forum. This is just a place where criminals do criminal things. And here a criminal organization advertises their Steam phishing service. This then leads to a Telegram group where you then get in contact with the operators. But to now actually get access to the service, you will have to get vetted. This is so they can have more control over who gets in or not, hoping to stop any bad guys, which are in this case the good guys, who try to take this down. So after you convince them, you will get an account for the service. Now you can start setting up your Steam phishing page and start trying to phish people. This means there's not just one person or a small team doing the Steam phishing page. It's lots and lots of people doing it. It's phishing as a service. I find this surprising and not surprising at the same time. In the real world, a website builder service makes sense. You have a few skilled developers that create a website building and hosting service like WordPress or Squarespace, and then you have hundreds or thousands of non-programmers who want websites but cannot code, so they get your service and easily create one. From a startup business perspective, this makes sense, right? Creating an online service is so much more scalable to making money than making individual websites. And so it shouldn't be a surprise that this is the same thing here in the cybercrime world. You have a few people who know how to program, who may come up with clever phishing ideas and know how to run their infrastructure, and then you have thousands of unskilled people that use the service, which means they generate a Steam phishing page, maybe a skin giveaway, a Discord Nitro giveaway, whatever they want. And then these unskilled workers try to find victims. They spam you on Discord. They spam you in YouTube or Twitter comments. They buy fake ads on Google, whatever it takes to find victims. But of course, the service doesn't come for free. In the real world, you usually pay a monthly fee, but here in the crime world, it works a bit different. As far as I understand, when you actually succeed in phishing an account, you don't really get this account. You are just the lowest level of the crime organization. Accounts will be listed here in the service dashboard, like on this screenshot that somebody shared. And look, there is an auto sale system, market settings, customized API and prices. What are your minimum prices for the different games? This is insane. Apparently, the black market for these hacked accounts has an API where you can automatically list and sell your phished accounts. Here's, for example, such a market, and you can see some of the accounts offered here. It shows you the games on the account, and you even have a 3-day warranty. So these services, the phishing service, as well as the market, it's all interconnected. Everything is streamlined, so the service operators are in control, and then they can take their percentages. This is organized and ran like a business, with customer service and rules. Even these crime websites have something like terms of service. Check this out. Project rules. If you get denied before and you registered with a different friend or multi-account, this is punishable by blocking. And the similarities to normal business goes further. They also try to do fun marketing stuff. Apparently for Christmas, they ask everybody to share screenshots of the highest value stolen accounts as a way to engage the community. Or they write step-by-step tutorials how to buy a domain and use it for phishing. It's really clever. Because this way, they just operate the infrastructure and it's much easier to hide. Because hundreds or maybe thousands of unskilled workers who have no clue how this stuff actually works, they register the domains, maybe in their own names. They sign up for social media accounts. They bear the risk of doing the cybercrime. They make the operational mistakes. The service operators are well shielded from doing the actual dirty work. So what can we learn from all of this? Well, cybercrime works like any other online business. Skilled workers earn a lot of money by creating services that then the unskilled workers can use. This scales a lot better, money volume wise, but also mitigates risks. As a skilled developer, you don't have to figure out how to build and maintain a Discord, YouTube, or Twitter spam bot network. You just get hundreds of teenagers to do it by hand for you because you promise them they will get rich by doing phishing. Also, you don't really need to test and optimize the phishing configuration templates and the delivery because you have hundreds of small workers doing it for you. And keep in mind, this is just one organization. I briefly mentioned it. There's also market competition between different service providers. These phishing pages from my previous video is a different one than the one shown here. This is pure capitalism at work. So let's come back to the original topic of the video. When you hear about cybercrime in the news, it's often used together with the word hacking. Companies get hacked, account gets hacked, but most cybercrime has nothing or very little to do with actual hacking. If you look at the definition of cybercrime on Wikipedia, it states, a cybercrime is a crime involving a computer or computer network. And this is what we have seen in this video. Some criminals use an online service to generate a phishing website and try to trick victims into giving up their credentials. These criminals maybe call themselves hackers, at least the victims say their accounts got hacked. But in the end, it's probably just a 16-year-old kid in a country with a struggling economic system, having no perspective for the future, who was promised money by using an online service to commit crime. There's no technical skill required. All they have to do is spam YouTube comments and Discord DMs. And so hacking, on the other hand, is so much more beautiful. Hacking may mean either attacking of systems to cause corruption of systems, or it may refer to learning of systems through disassembly and probing. It's about the intellectual challenge of creatively overcoming the limitations of software systems or electronic hardware. And you see, this has nothing to do with what we saw in this video. That's why I think the crime stuff does not deserve to be called hacking. Now, if you are interested in learning real hacking, I can recommend you to start by learning programming. How about make your own website without a website builder just to practice this? There's a good chance you can find some jobs online with that. And then check out some of my videos. I have hundreds of videos about hacking with various skill requirements. I will link a few starting points below. And as ChatGPT would say, do IT, not crime, develop software, not crime. Thanks again to Cyber, the person who shared this stuff with me. They actually put a lot of time into identifying these services and reporting them to take them down. I wish I could tell you how exactly he achieves that, but that would probably just help the criminals. So I better not share those details. But I still have another recommendation what you can do if you want to help as well. If you come across a phishing page, you can submit it to the Safe Browsing Project. It doesn't take much time and it's not a guarantee that something is done, but it could lead to the site getting blocked in browsers. This is the red warning page you sometimes get when clicking on links. So this may protect a possible future victim. Oh, I just got a message from ChatGPT. Let me quickly check this out.
Speaking of victims, cybercrime is a serious threat that can affect anyone, from individuals to entire organizations. However, with LiveOverflow, a new solution is available to help lower these risks. This font is based on the distinctive handwriting of LiveOverflow, a renowned cybersecurity expert and hacker who has dedicated his career to exposing vulnerabilities and preventing cyber attacks. Now, you can harness the power of his expertise with this unique font, which not only looks great but also offers added security benefits. Available exclusively at shop.liveoverflow.com, LiveOverFont is a must-have for anyone serious about protecting their digital assets. So don't wait. Download LiveOverFont today and give yourself the extra layer of protection you deserve.
Not sure if that is all true, but thanks, ChatGPT. I appreciate the kind words. See you.